Good morning, Associate Professor Charan Sri Mitpanon, Chair of the 5th Gas Traveling Conference 2014 at the Faculty of ICT, Mahidol University, Thailand. Professor Hendrik Kern, Speaker of the German ASEAN Science and Technology Network. Ms. Annette Severi, Head of the Press and Cultural Affairs, the Embassy of the Federal Republic of Germany in Bangkok. Invited speakers, distinguished guests, colleagues, and students, I would like to welcome you to the second day of the 5th Gas Traveling Conference 2014 on IT security at the Faculty of ICT, Mahidol University, Thailand. Before we begin our main event, I would like to briefly describe the conference program today as follows. After the opening ceremony, the morning session consists of 5 talks on the topics of security in communication networks, technical and non-technical issues by Professor Otto Spaniel. IT security, from network to cloud by Assistant Professor Susungwan Ngam Suriyaroth. Cloud security framework by Ms. Nantawan Wongkachonkiti. Thai CERT, the role of national CERT in Thai cybersecurity by Dr. Saranan Jiwasurat. And evolution of threats and threats roundup for the first half of 2014 by Mr. Kongsak Gautakun. The afternoon session will consist of 5 talks, which are botnets by Professor Sureswaran Ramadas. Safeguarding yourself from social engineering attacks, understanding the deception strategy to build human firewalls by Professor Richardas Eko Indrajit. Challenges and solutions in hardware security by Dr. Michael Pelt. Education as Root for Security, IULI, a new academic platform for the GAS network by Professor Peter O. Shit. And Intrusion Detection in Computer Networks by Professor Michael Toulouse. All talks will happen in this room, and lunch will be provided at the Biz and Vice Hall. The break will be served outside this room. Light dinners or light refreshments will be provided at the end of today's session. Now it is a good time to officially start the conference. I would like to invite Associate Professor Charan Sri Mitpanon, Chair of the 5th Gas Traveling Conference 2014 at Mahidol University, to kindly give the welcome speech. Associate Professor Charan Sri, would you please?
Good morning. Our honorary guest, Mrs. Annette Severi from the German Embassy, Professor Spino, our keynote from Aachen University, Professor Kent, coordinator of the German ASEAN Science and Technology Network, our guest, all the speakers of GAS Network, distinguished guests, colleges, and students. On behalf of the Faculty of ICT, I would like to welcome you to the second day, second country of the 5th Gas Traveling Conference 2014 in Thailand. The Faculty of ICT, Mahidol University, and GAS Network have established the relationship for quite some time, especially in the form of the faculty and student research and exchange collaborations. And it is my utmost pleasure to finally be able to organize an event such as this. This event is a very important event to strengthen the collaboration between the Faculty of ICT and GAS Network. I have to thank Professor Spaniel Professor Johnson, Dr. Titinan, Dr. Susungwan, Dr. Songsi, and Dr. Bunsit, who greatly helped coordinate this event, and particularly Professor Khan. As we all know that the world has become increasingly interconnected, and more businesses and more people in the world are using information technology than ever before. At the same time, we heard about security breach issues more often, and the damage has been increasing. The damage done by hackers and stalkers is now not just the loss of the money, but also the loss of reputation and threatened life values, which could cripple a business and a digital social life greatly. As the world is now moving towards the social and society of digital economy and digital life, it is important to secure the digital economy and personal content value so that the people can feel safe. After I have attended the first day of GAS conference in Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam, I believe that with the experts in the IT security field, we should put our knowledge, creativity, and our determination to not only invent the new technology, but also to increase responsibility to find a highly secure platform or environment to ensure the highest security to all normal digital citizens of the world, from technology stream to social usage stream. The unique objective of this conference is to bring together leading experts from Germany and Southeast Asia countries to share knowledge and experiences in the area of IT security. The conference targets audience from academia, industry, and research institutes, and cover both theoretical conference and practical aspect of IT security, including the trends of IT security. This year, the GAS conference is hosted in three different countries, which are Vietnam, at the Vietnam German University, Thailand at Mahidol University, and Singapore at the German Institute of Science and Technology, TUM Asia. Mahidol University is one of the largest and oldest universities in Thailand. It organized as and originated as a hospital in 1888, and since then became Mahidol University in 1969. The name Mahidol was after the Majesty, the King's father, His Royal Highness Prince Mahidol of Songkhla. Mahidol University excels in medical-related disciplines and is ranked first in Thailand according to the QS University Ranking Asia since 2011. The university has six major campuses around Thailand and has the most number of full professors in the nation. This very campus, Salaya campus, is the main campus of the university, hosting approximately 18,000 undergraduate students, 9,000 graduate students, and 3,600 academic staff, and also about 25,000 of supporting staff to handle five hospitals. The Faculty of ICT has its root from the Department of Computer Science, Faculty of Science, and Computing Center at Mahidol University. With a vision to produce top quality graduates to support the demand of the IT industry in Thailand, the Faculty of ICT developed academic programs certified by the Ministry of Thailand in the undergraduate and graduate levels based on the ACM and IEEE computing curriculum guidelines. In this year, we just offer two new master programs, namely Master of Science in Cybersecurity and Information Assurance, and Master of Science in Game Technology and Gamification, which started in this month. Graduates of the Faculty of ICT are found to be very, very successful in job placement and continuing education in the postgraduate levels abroad. Students of the Faculty of ICT also win numerous awards, both internationally and nationally, on a regular basis. The faculty staff also work on contemporary research areas, such as cybersecurity, computer vision, green technology, game technology, image recognition, virtual reality, vehicular communication, and also high throughput computational area. I would like to thank all the experts who are here with us today to share, especially our speaker consisting of Professor Spaniel from Aachen University as our keynote, Assistant Professor Susunguan from our Faculty of ICT, Mahidol University, Ms. Nantawan from Electronic Government Agency, Thailand, Dr. Soranan from ThaiCert, Mr. Kong Sak from 10 Micro, Thailand, Professor Ramadas from National Advanced IPv6 Center, Malaysia, Professor Indajit from the National Research Council, Indonesia, International University, Lausanne, Indonesia, Dr. Ying Pelt from Professor Scheidt from International University, Lausanne, Indonesia, and Professor Toulouse from Vietnamese German University. I also would like to thank our staff who helped organize this event. Most importantly, I would like to thank our sponsor, Germany's Federal Ministry of Education and Research, the German Embassy, and GAS Network for their finance and technical support. And of course, our friends from Southeast Asia countries who are joining in this conference. And now it is a very good time. Then I would like to officially open the second day, second country of the fifth GAS Tevring Conference 2014 in Thailand. I hope everyone here enjoyed the program and our arrangement today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Associate Professor Gerency. Next, I would like to invite Ms. Annette Severi, Head of the Press and Cultural Affairs from the Embassy of the Federal Republic of Germany in Bangkok, to kindly give welcome speech. Mrs. Severi, would you please?
Sawadika. Dear Associate Professor Charemsi, Dean of the Faculty of ICT of the Mahidol University, dear distinguished professors from Germany and from ASEAN countries, I would like to name two representatives, the speaker of the guest network, Professor Kern, and Professor Schwamjul from the RWTH Aachen. Dear distinguished researchers, members of the public interested in this special topic. Dear participants, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. It gives me an outstanding pleasure to be here with you today at the 5th Gast Traveling Conference on IT Security here in the Mahidol University at Nakhonpattom. Mahidol University maintains a big number of cooperation programs with German universities, and I'm always happy to be here in this wonderful, renowned university with this marvelous campus. The topic you chose for this year's conference could not be more timely, as the internet is one of the fastest growing phenomena of our time, thus imposing new challenges on us every day. Also in Germany, the topic IT and IT security plays a decisive role. The German Federal Minister for Traffic, Construction and Urban Development, Mr. Alexander Dobrindt, has just presented the new digital agenda of the German government. Today, 85% of Germans use broadband access to the internet. Until 2018, the speed of the networks are to guarantee a faster access of 50 megabit per second using optical fiber cables or mobile broadband. With a mobile communication technology, LTE, transfer times of 100 megabit per second are possible. For the German industry, which is predominantly export-oriented, using IT connecting to the rest of the world is of highest importance. Not only the big, but also small and medium-sized companies forming the backbone of German economy have branch offices in other countries and need to coordinate production, design, or sales activities. Here in Thailand alone, there are 600 German companies who depend on that. When preparing for the conference, I came over some figures you may know already, but I was fascinated by them. In 1986, 280 petabytes worldwide were conveyed through the telecommunication network, while only 20% of this data were transmitted via digital networks. In 2007, however, the capacity of information increased up to 65 exabytes, and the percentage of information transmitted digitally rose up to 99%. This means that worldwide information capacity exceeds worldwide economic growth by 5 times. According to IBM, 2.5 exabytes of new data were generated daily in 2012, and about 2,940 billion emails are sent every day. If those emails were actual letters in paper form, it's estimated that it would take about 2 years to process that many pieces of mail in the United States. In 2013, Asia has had the biggest share of internet users, accounting to more than 1.2 billion people, or 45% of worldwide internet users, with, of course, China being the biggest contributor, followed by Vietnam, Indonesia, and Thailand. 1/3 of the world population is active on the internet, but others may be involved passively when they provide their data to third parties who store them digitally. Dealing with information technology has become part of everyday life for many people in an industrialized world. It's incorporated in our daily routine so much that sometimes you don't even realize its presence and the consequences arising from that presence anymore. For a long time, society showed a tendency to only embrace the advantages of IT-related products and processes and neglected thorough thoughts on security issues. Thankfully, this has started to change, and conferences like this one today have contributed outstandingly to this development. Communication is desirable in most contexts. This is why we're here today, to communicate new developments and findings, share opinions and knowledge important to everyone. Information technology has helped creating today's gathering. Of course, it has given the occasion to talk about IT security. On the other hand, modern communication measures are convenient to reduce the tremendous effort of organizing a major event like the GAS conference, involving people from different countries, different continents, and different time zones. At this point, I would like to heartfully thank the organizers for so wonderfully establishing and preparing this conference today. Email is only one achievement of IT technology that has become indispensable in our daily lives. We distribute professional and personal communication on various channels and networks through the internet. If we desire any information, we consult search engines. We order goods and services from marketing platforms. We manage our bank accounts and tax declarations online. Our smartphones are always within reach, and soon there will be smart watches around our wrists. New IT-based devices are invented constantly to make people's life easier. This has led to the aforementioned incredible growth in the capacity of data transported online. The most well-known example of data expansion and data storage are probably Facebook and Google, the social networks. Facebook is estimated to collect an amount of more than 500 terabytes each day from their 950 million users. According to a report of 2006, Google has stored over a petabyte of information in their user database. But those are only the most popular examples. Almost every company, organization, or institution that collects data stores this information on computers, servers, or clouds. While it is the responsibility of those who collect data to administrate and use it only limited boundaries, defined by economic and ethical considerations, there's an ever-growing list of incidents in which unauthorized third parties have overcome existing security measures and sensitive data had been illegally accessed, manipulated, or stolen. The first known hacker apparently appeared in 1981. Pat Riddle entered the computer system of the US Ministry of Defense multiple times, which led to the introduction of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act in 1986. This law served as a base on which criminals like Riddle could be convicted. The first hacker this law was applied to in 1990 was Robert Tappan Morris, who released the Morris Worm in 1988, and is now, in fact, a renowned expert on computer science. Various cases of data theft or abuse have since made their way into the news. These examples and many more clearly show that IT security is not only a challenge that is present all the time, but also a global challenge. That's what makes it crucial that we work together globally to face this challenge. I would like to thank the German ASEAN Science and Technology Network and everyone associated with the organization of today's conference for their tremendous efforts in lining up that event. You have managed to gather an impressive list of top scholars from Germany and ASEAN who I firmly believe will bring new insights and enlighten all of us today. I would also like to express my gratitude to all of today's lecturers for participating in this important conference here in Bangkok. As for the danger that may come up, I would also like to point out to something which was recently organized in a little town close to my hometown Karlsruhe, namely in Ettlingen. Most of the people do not know Ettlingen, but when it comes to cybersecurity, I think, at least in Germany, but even beyond that, many people know that. That is because also public service utilities and state functions are more and more based on IT and therefore vulnerable. Recently, about a year ago, I think, or 9 months ago, Ettlingen, this small town, invited hackers to try and access their networks they thought were rather safe. The participants of the so-called penetration test took less than 2 days to close down the electricity supply of the city. Luckily, it was a friendly test, but it really caused widespread interest among decision makers in politics, economy, and research. Since we all obviously use the internet for online banking, private emails, internet shopping, and so on, we know that also privately our data are sensible. But obviously also all the businesses doing business with companies in other parts of the world, all the researchers exchanging their findings need to protect their data. And if a loss occurs of data, the loss of data can be costly or embarrassing, as the recent theft of private pictures stored on clouds and the following illegitimate publication clearly showed. While it is important to provide, as you could see, the sufficient speed in the internet, it is even more important to guarantee security and to beef up security in order to protect the data and infrastructure of our daily lives. Therefore, I'm very happy that you, the leading experts for IT security, came together to this conference today to exchange your views on this burning issue. We at the German Embassy follow the cooperation programs in the field of sciences and academic cooperation very closely. I would like to inform you that Thailand is the country with which German University maintain the highest number of university exchange programs throughout ASEAN. Over 170 of these exchange programs exist. I'm very happy to see that, and as I said, the embassy follows it very closely and tries to support wherever it's possible. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to wish you now an insightful and fruitful discussion and exchange, and wish you all the best for the conference and your research. For all the visitors from overseas, I would like to wish you a pleasant stay. Khob khun mak ka. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Savory. Next, I would like to invite Associate Professor Jerency Mitpanon, Chair of the second day of the GAS Traveling Conference 2014, to give the gift of appreciation to the to Ms. Savory. Next, I would like to invite Professor Henrik Kahn, Speaker of the German ASEAN Science and Technology Network, to give a welcome speech. Professor Kahn, would you please?
Dear Professor Jerency, dear Councillor Savory, dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank you for staying here at Mahidol University to celebrate with us the opening of the fifth GAS Traveling Conference in 2014. It's a real pleasure for me to cordially welcome you all at the fifth conference here in this ICT department after mass transport technologies with a focus on high-performance railway systems in 2010, electromobility for megacities in 2011, medical technologies in 2012, and energy-efficient buildings in 2013, which, parenthetically mentioned, were all topics of high relevance at its time. This year's theme focuses on IT security, a topic that, especially in the last time, has moved in the broad focus of the public. NSA and Edward Snowden are only two popular buzzwords, but IT security goes far beyond and affects us in every area of our lives. Not only eavesdropping or interception of data affects safety, but also any malfunction of a software-controlled facility or installation, either by bugs in the software or by externally induced malfunction, like with the controllers of the centrifuges of the Iranian nuclear activities. But, for example, also like one of the latest cases in automotive industry, the failure of the airbag controllers in Audi's R4, where, up to now, it's not quite clear if it's a software bug or an accidental coincidence of electrical effects. With increasing network activities, for example in vehicles, like automatic updates of software controlling, of intercommunication between cars and with base stations, and so on, or the fully remote control home via smartphone, to give only some examples, much more attention has to be paid to IT security and secure systems. The conference covers this subject and highlights various topics in the coming speeches. I may announce that our speakers will discuss various themes in their contributions and present latest results of their research in order to give a valuable contribution to a highly interesting conference. The organization behind the conference, the GAST, German ASEAN Science and Technology Network, is a liaison of five German universities with their partner institutions in ASEAN countries, namely INSTEC, RWTH Aachen with Mahidol University here in Bangkok, TU Darmstadt with Vietnam German University in Ho Chi Minh City, where we stayed 2 days ago, University Duisburg-Essen with University Kebang Sang Malaysia in Kuala Lumpur, TU München with Tumasia in Singapore, where we will stay in 2 days, and my own university, TU Ilmenau, with Yuli International University Liaison Indonesia in BSD Jakarta. The GAST network was founded in November 2009 as a platform to systematically develop German-ASEAN science and technology cooperation. At the same time, the network sought to specifically enhance synergies and networking among institutions and groups in Southeast Asia that had pre-existing ties with Germany. Since early 2011, in conjunction with the restructuring of the GAST network, the focus of GAST has been opened also towards industrial and commercial cooperation to support the transfer of technologies from Germany to Southeast Asia and vice versa. GAST also acts as network to offer the model of German engineering and science education in these countries. The most recent result of these efforts is the establishment of the International University Liaison Indonesia in Jakarta, where my university, TU Ilmenau, provides significant support. And what's worthable to note is that the university gets the license on a very famous date. That was the date of the reunification of Germany, the 3rd of October this year. The conference hosted by GAST Network are organized as so-called traveling conferences. The main difference to common conferences is the fact that the conference takes place at three locations within 1 week. Since in this case the speakers are traveling, significantly more interested persons from science, economy and politics are able to participate and to discuss actual themes of common interest. From the beginning, the conferences are financially supported by the German Federal Ministry of Education and Research. This support, which emphasizes the importance attributed to the conference by the ministry, is gratefully acknowledged. My thanks also go to all those hands who helped to bring the conference to life. Without these helpers in the backstage, a conference like this would not be possible. I wish you, I wish us all, an interesting conference with deep insights to newest development in IT security. And now it's time to vacate the stage for the next speaker, who will give the first conference speech. It's a pleasure for me to announce Professor Spaniol from RWTH Aachen, who has contacts here to Mahidol University. He was chair of communication and distribution system, and he will give a lecture on security and communication networks, especially on technical and non-technical issues. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Kern. Next, I would like to invite all the invited speakers and also Associate Professor Chiranjeevi Mitpanon, Chair of the 5th GAST Traveling Conference 2014, Ms. Savary, Professor Kern, to step up on the stage to take a group photos, and also all invited speakers as well, please. Next, I would like to invite Professor Otto Spaniol to give the first presentation on the topic of security in communication networks, technical and non-technical issues. Professor Otto Spaniol is currently the chair of the Communication and Distributed System at RWTH Aachen, Aachen University in Germany. His expertise covers many networking-related areas such as wireless and mobile systems, next-generation internet, multimedia communications. Professor Spaniol, would you please?
Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to be here to give this opening speech. And as Annette Savary and Professor Kern have already said, security issues have gained much more momentum than before. And this is indeed true. When we discussed 2 years ago, when we had just finalized the topic for 2013, what would happen in 2014 in the GAST traveling conference series, then I proposed the topic security. And then, believe it or not, people said, oh, come on, security is absolutely uninteresting, nobody will deal with that in America or in Asia, only maybe in paranoid countries such as Germany, this is a topic, but things since then have changed drastically, and security is everywhere. And I can only give a small introduction in the topics. First, we can say that security has two facets. One is a technical facet, and one is a non-technical facet. And at technical universities, of course, we deal mostly with technical things. Since this, we trust more and we feel on safe grounds. We have our techniques, we have our models, and so on. But my desire for today is also to give some largely non-technical aspects. If we have security in technical sense, then we have mostly abbreviations such as CIA. It's not the institution in the US, but it means confidentiality. It means integrity and availability. Confidentiality says that the messages you exchange or the data you exchange should be and remain confidential. So only the partners can see and decode it. Moreover, there are other aspects, such for example, people ask that some communications should remain anonymous, otherwise it could be detected who communicates with whom, and this also can have a security issue. And another aspect, there are so many aspects, every year we have new aspects, is the location of network partners. It is a payment for the partners, and so on and so on. The second point is integrity, where we would like to guarantee that the messages as we send them are unchanged, delivered to the partner. So the forging of message contents should be detected, including the forging of sender addresses. And the recipient should also be able to prove that a message was sent and that the addressee has received the message. And then, of course, a lot of things depends on money, usage fees, and everything else. And finally, the A for CIA stands for availability. So we should, the network should be good enough that the communication is possible. And that only those guys who are allowed to do communication could use the services of the network. And here in this case, we have another decoding, maybe for the A is authentication, where you have to prove that you are the correct guy who does this. In the last 2 years, we have seen a lot of attacks against networks and on computers, and attacks are twofold. First, against the computer, and a single computer, in this case, the attacker must have physical access, and secondly, the attack against a network of stations, of computers. And this can be done by various protocol tools which have been developed in good faith by some technician, and so we have now to fight against the consequences. Attacks on communication processes or on communication via networks are much more complicated to detect. We will see also today some talks about intrusion detection and other things. Here we have passive attacks, where the attacker only wants to listen to the traffic on the network, and then he can maybe understand what is going on, or he can make a traffic analysis of the traffic and maybe detect that some automotive company has all of a sudden has a lot of messages with another automotive company, such as BMW in Germany had with MG in United Kingdom, and then they could detect that maybe BMW buys a part of this factory. On the other hand, we have active attacks, which are much more dangerous. In this case, we modify, extend, delete, replay data units. We modify something, and we disturb the network very seriously. And we have other things, such as denial of service attacks. Also, here we have a talk today. For example, one of the earliest such attacks is the TCP SYN flood attack. The denial of service attack tries to overflow the network by a lot of useless messages such that the network becomes inoperable. And this attack can be done not only from a single point on the from a single station, but coordinated by stations worldwide, by somebody else, and the other stations that do not even know that there are partners in this bad game. The TCP SYN flood, I explained it in Ho Chi Minh City also a little, is the following. If you try to connect with a TCP protocol, then you have a threefold sequence of messages. You have a request, this has to be acknowledged, and then you have to finalize the request in step number three. Now with this SYN flood, the active partner, number one, waits for the acknowledgement, but then does not give the acknowledgement of that, but lets this connection open. And indeed, it brings new connection requests, and of course, those requests will be finished after a certain time out. But in this time, there are so many other open connections that the connection partner on the other end will be totally overloaded and cannot do any serious things. Now, if you want to produce good security technique, then you have to first to say we need some trusted parts. If you cannot trust anybody, you are lost anyway. So we have here in this picture, we have two trusted domains, left and right, and in the middle there is a bad world where everything can happen. And you have to guarantee that no harm will be done. First things is, in order to do so, is encryption. So you encrypt your messages with a key, K. This key is a certain bit length, has a certain bit length, not too high. And this key is a major problem is to give your key safely to the partner. This can be done maybe even by conventional letter or by a public key scheme discussed later on. And then together with the key, we have the encryption algorithm and the decryption algorithm. And it is assumed that nobody can break the encryption. So then, if the partner wants to send you a message, M, then he uses the encryption algorithm, gives the result to the bad world, and then it comes to me, and I decrypt it. I check whether it is okay, whether the message comes out, or whether another undecipherable thing comes out. And so we believe that this is a good scheme for encrypting the messages. Another problem is the authentication. Here you have to prove that you are the correct partner who is allowed to send you messages. In this case, also you send the key to your partner, and you have an authentication algorithm. And then if you send the message M, You authorized the message with this authorized K and M additional message. This can be, for example, a digital signature. And then the partner checks whether the received message M and the authorized message are the same. If they are the same, then he trusts that this is the correct message. How do we do that? Now this is a little bit indeed mathematics, but not written here. We need then so-called hash functions. They can be used for variable input lengths, but produce a small output, which is a certain number of bits, maybe 128. And this should be a so-called one-way function, which is very easy to compute, but which cannot be recomputed from the other side, practically infeasible. Even if it is theoretically possible, but if you would find a method to invert such a hash function, then you would immediately throw away the algorithm H and replace it by something else. This has, by the way, happened in the development of such techniques, that somebody found by poor accident two messages, this one and this one, that produced the same hash value, and then the algorithm was canceled. Now, since already a number of years, we have so-called public encryption key encryption schemes, where we have two keys per user. The user has a public key, such as his telephone number, openly written in a telephone book, and he has a secret key. Both are a pair, and if you get a public key encoded with your public key message, and this can be done by everybody, then only you can decrypt the message. So then you send the public key to your partner, he sends you the message he wants, message M, encoded with your public key, and only you can decrypt this message. But there, of course, there is something which is missing. For example, since everybody can encode a message for you, since everybody knows your public key, so Professor Kern can send me a message, and maybe also Dr. Titinan can send a message in the name of Dr. Kern, and so I have to guarantee that Dr. Kern was the sender of the message. How to do that? And this is done by digital signature schemes. In this case, you send the message, but then you have also a signature algorithm, which is basically a secret key, done by your secret key, which in turn can be decoded by everybody, but can only be produced by the correct sender. It is such like a signature on a check on the bank. It is assumed that your signature, handwritten signature, cannot be reproduced by another
person. Anonymity, I have said, but I would like to say one or two sentences. More and more people want that the communication between the good friends, Alice and Bob, all with the same names, not even the content of the communication can be decoded, can be seen, but only also that there were messages cannot be seen. And this is for some people very important. And you can do that by a lot of techniques, for example, by so-called mixed networks, where you swim like
fish in the big water where a million of other fish swim, and then it is practically impossible to find out what is the message between Alice and Bob. But of course, this is still a research topic. My intention is to speak a little bit more on non-technical issues who came into effect since, I would say, 2 years or 3 years, like this, the story which was told by Snowden and NSA and so on, and politics, non-technical issues, but they have many, many facets. We can say that insufficient security cannot be solved alone by technical issues, but it can be the consequence due to, I would say, pure stupidity. And this is my example, which I will bring now. And it can also be an enforcement to money saving, and then to bring products hastily on the market, which are not mature, or to negligence of users. For example, many users use the same password. They have 20 different versions, but they all combine it to one password. And if this password is stolen, then of course the security aspect, you can forget about it. But I would like to bring a very crazy example, one really crazy. It's a Heartbleed bug. The Heartbleed is a attack against the Heartbeat protocol, which is now 2 years old and which has a very serious deficiency. And this Heartbeat has been specified only in February 2012 and has been already removed because it was so crazy. But nevertheless, it was installed and is still installed in many systems, maybe a million of systems or something like that. The intention of the Heartbeat protocol is simply a message or a sequence of messages that allow to detect whether your partner is still alive. If there is no answer to such a message during a certain timeout period, then your partner believes that you are not alive anymore and that you are not available for the moment being. This is done by Heartbeat in a very easy way. It sends a certain quantity of data, which is composed of important data and some padding. The padding are some random data which were introduced in order to not give an attacker a chance to speculate what is done here by giving so-called known plain text attacks. So the Heartbeat protocol operates, send you a payload, a few number of bits, and a certain number of padding bits. And the partner has to send back the payload part in an unchanged way, and with the other, he can do whatever he wants. And if this is functioning correctly, then the sender believes that the partner is alive. Now, the Heartbleed attack was invented, since in the implementation of the protocol, it was forgotten to check whether the indicated length of the data part corresponds to the real data part length of the testing message, which is so stupid that not even a student in the first semester should forget it. So it could be either stupidity or it should be on purpose, that somebody wanted to bring a bug in the system by doing that in this way. But the check was forgotten. So now, if the indicated data is bigger than the real data, then the partner will send you more data than you have asked for. As an analogy, you ask for a telephone number and you get back the entire telephone book, including the very secret numbers, and etc. And this, of course, nobody wanted. So you, by this, you can draw a lot of data from the working storage of the partner, and the problem is even more serious since you can repeat the attack quite often. Here is the attack. In the upper part, there is a good case where the client wants to test whether the server is alive, and he says, if you are alive, then send back to me the following four characters, blah, B-L-A-H. Then the server sends back blah, and then things are okay. Now the second case, it's a simple attack. So the client sends a message, if you are alive, send back me the following 40,004, there's a certain limit, characters, blah. And the characters, the first four characters are that what should be sent back. And the partner then answers with blah, followed by 4,000 characters, which are maybe very sensitive. And so he opens a big leak in the system. So Heartbleed was a bug that leads to a security leak, concerns a lot of servers worldwide, remained undetected for more than two years, allows an attacker to read parts of the working storage, and for example, passwords, keys, and so on can be stolen, is sometimes hard to detect and has far-reaching consequences. For example, even today, you can have collected data on your server and you check this offline with the material that has been stolen. Now, it could, of course, be corrected, the mistake, by just making a check whether the indicated data is the same as the real data. And this was still forgotten. How could that happen? Now, first, it is the Heartbleed bug is a so-called buffer overread. You send a small buffer size and you get back a big buffer size, also with dangerous content, and was produced due to money saving. The team who did that had only one permanently paid member. And this member wanted to make money a little by himself. He hired a piece of code that was developed by a student of University Duisburg-Essen, that is a partner of our network. And this guy had in mind to do this for a planned PhD thesis. And then the code was even produced by student helpers without any experience. But the result was that the code was submitted to the Internet Engineering Task Force by the student and by two co-authors. And later on, when it was detected, oh, catastrophe, the programmer admitted that the mistake was trivial, it was very serious, but not intended. But this does not really help. So, and the programmer even said that very few people test the validity of the coding of some implementations. And this is a very dangerous statement, to my opinion. Now, I would like to conclude my talk. I wanted to tell you that security has many facets, technical issues and non-technical issues. Technical issues are numerous and dealt by people from universities, technical universities, with enormous effort and with also considerable success. But there is the second half is missing. The non-technical issues are very, very numerous too, and not so easy to describe and to classify. We, every month we have new systems which are new reasons for non-technical security leaks. And in order to cope with them, we have at first do good education of users such that such programming mistakes cannot be happen anymore. And also we have to educate people that they behave in a way honestly. But there are so many reasons for such problems that it is practically impossible to resolve them due to the nature of human beings. And the good thing with that is that there is plenty of research and education efforts for the next 10, 20, 30 years. Every bad thing has also good things. And so the security expert will have a good job in the next decade. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Spaniel. I would like to ask the audience if there is any question. There are two microphones on the side. You can go to the microphone and ask questions. Are there any questions? If not, then thank you very much, Professor Spaniel. Thank you. And next, I would like to invite Assistant Professor Sungwon Ngam Suryaroj from the Faculty of ICT to give a presentation on IT security from network to cloud. Assistant Professor Ngam Suryaroj is currently a faculty member of the Faculty of ICT, Mahidol University. Her research areas include high performance computing, network and database security, and health information technology. Assistant Professor Ngam Suryaroj has more than 10 years of experience managing Mahidol University network before the establishment of the Faculty of ICT. Ajahn Sungwon, would you please?
Good morning. Maybe my slide is not really long, okay? So I would like to go briefly on each topic, and then we, Kunantawan, we go to detail on the cloud security later. Okay. So Professor Otto already talked about the goals of security that we know as CIA, the confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Okay. Now, in terms of the goals is to do asset protection. And asset protection is like we decide have like CIA here. But when we talk about what asset, and the asset mostly will be on data or information. And so we have to consider the state of information from that the data is in storage, is in transmission, or in the processing. So we have the information state in this cube here. Now, beyond that, we need to have security countermeasures. So it's not just technology that also Otto talking about technical issue, but we also have about another non-technical issue. So in the organization, you need to have like policy and some like best practice for the organization to so that people will follow the policy, or you have rules or regulation that to ensure that the security of your organization is still like well protected. So the service will be from availability, integrity, authentication, confidentiality, and even the non-repudiation. That means you cannot deny what you have done. Okay, so that's what the goals that we have for protection. So in the big pictures of securities, this is the IT system, all data assets that we want to protect, right? And then we need to have control. The control is something that mechanism or something that we want to put to protect our data. Now, the control can drive driven by the policy, and even we have laws and regulation, and that we could have the standards, some guidance, and we also have some tests on the evidence and whatever you have on the incident that come. So that comes with control. Now, the control is we want to have the, usually the, or any system we have risk, okay? And the risk creates threats and also some vulnerabilities to the IT system. And that could be the risk can have from business process itself, and that is from the business strategy, and that's why we need to have like the security architecture to give you some idea to include into the control, and that is to use it to protect, to minimize risk, or probably like try to avoid risk that can create threat and vulnerability to the IT system. So in the security mechanism and control, we have, first we want to try to do prevention. So like, for example, we have cryptography so that if our data is encrypted and we know the key and nobody else know, then the data is not exposed to someone else. And we have MAC or digital signature message integrity that also Otto already is talking about. We also have like access control, right? And also intrusion detection prevention that is on the prevention, and also overlap to the detection, the second mechanism to try to monitor and also audit to the system. And then we have the compensation. If something has gone wrong, and then we want to recover from whatever happened, and we try to minimize damage, okay? And that we have like redundancy or like failover. And that with the have fault tolerance system, we have the logging, auditing, and all of this, we have the security policy cover, okay? And that would be the something that we, in the big organization, we need to define the good security policy to ensure that your assets have been well protected. Okay. So in terms of the landscape of the security, we start with some technical from the security service like identification, authentication, authorization, identity management, or detail, and then backup redundancy. But we also have other things like net infrastructure patterns, like in the network and communication, they put it all together. And we also have the threat from the software, like we talk about heartbeat, that is a vulnerability that happened when we design SSL, and then there's some mistake. Like small mistake in the SSL, so that causes problem. So in the application platform, then you need to have like database well protected, and then the internet web servers. And then we have the IT application level patterns that talking about like architectural size, including SOA, NTIA, architecture and software as a service that we're using now. And then the collaboration software like email, document exchange, instant messaging. So on top of that, we need to have like IT service security patterns that cover service management, share management, service operation, like including share management, incident management, and that is all gone to the the level of management that we need to have. And on this side, with about the governance, from the policy, strategy, laws, and responsibility of any users that have access to the system. And then the metrics and risk management, very big topic in information security management, including the law, the legal and regulatory. So in the IT security component, then we have, we can see this one, you have a lot in the circle, from risk assessment, network, security, and access control, business continuity, compliance, and confidentiality. So network security is just a part of, it's a big part of the IT security, but it's not really the whole thing yet. So we have many components that we have to include to ensure that our system will be well protected, and if anything happens, the damage happens, then we try to recover and minimize the damage as minimum as possible. So in terms of the fundamental of network security, we talk about attack. We know a lot about attack, like SyncFlood, DOS, DDoS, and then we need to have like countermeasure. And the countermeasure, we have a lot of things. It's have a lot of varieties. We cannot using one solution for all. We have to use many solutions here. And then we have like the model on the network, OSI model or TCP/IP. And then on the network security on those physical and logical network. From this, this is probably give an example of the network security control that we have. From we set up DMZ zone, we have the firewalls, we have the, if we have host and server attack, we have many firewall IDS, spam mail detection, a lot of things. If we have VPN that allow external user to access our network, then we have to protect on at the VPN too, and also on the mobile. Okay. So this is something about the network security. Now, if we move to cloud, if someone, I'm going to talk about briefly because I think some people may not really know the cloud model and then the nature of the cloud. So this is the from the NIST cloud framework. It has defined the characteristic of cloud in five essential characteristics, from on-demand self-service. So like when you want to use, you have server storage, you just click on the web portal and then it provides the machine for you. You don't have to have physical machine, but then you can use the storage or memory and network. So that is on-demand self-service. You need to have network access. So this is required like broadband network. And the cloud have resource pooling. This means that you have, you share many resources together. So it's cover like in the big data center for like Google or Microsoft, you have like almost million servers right now around the world, and we are sharing those resources. And then we need to have rapid elasticity. This is about scaling. It means that you can, if I want 3 servers right now, and in the next day I want 100 servers, it's impossible to buy those servers in one day. So you can, if you're using cloud, you can acquire 100 servers in one day, in 1 hour, if the provider can provide it for you. So that is mean the rapid elasticity. And then everything in cloud have to be able to measure. So that means people use one server have to pay less than people that use two servers, 10 servers, because you're using service that can measure, right? So everything in cloud have to be able to measure. And other common characteristic that we need in cloud, like, for example, virtualization, very big part in cloud. Without virtualization, probably there is no cloud. So NIST have defined the model for service model as infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. And then from that, we can deploy those services as a private cloud, public cloud, and then community cloud. And then if we use all of them together, then we can call hybrid cloud. Okay, so this is the big picture. So normally the service from the infrastructure have been used by platform, and the service from platform have been used by software as a service. And there are many companies that using the try to provide service for user at each level of the model. So then from the virtualization in cloud, give you some idea. So from the hardware layers, you have like server, CPUs, memory, network, storage. And then you have hypervisor that like we have like OS to try to like manage that the hardware layer for you. On top of that, you build the virtual CPU, virtual storage, virtual network, virtual memory. And you cannot let it this alone, then you have to manage. Because user coming in, they want many virtual CPU, then you have to provide it. If there is no CPU, no virtual CPU, then you have to have a way to say, okay, we need more, then we have to create, and then you have to talk to hypervisor to create it for you. Then on top of that, then you have the infrastructure as a service. And in one VM, one virtualization, then you can user can have their own OS. You can have Windows, Microsoft Windows, or Linux on top of this. And then you have platform as a service to provide a runtime library and then database. And then you can build the software as a service on top of the platform. Okay, so this is the same pictures, but what I would like to say is there will be some security service and management service from the infrastructure to platform and then to software as a service. So then we have, in the cloud, we also have threats similar to what we have in network or in IT, any IT system. So in this big picture, so if you have a cloud data center that have like network servers and all the application, then you need to have like some cloud management software to manage those server or virtual machine. And then that is support multi-tenancy. Tenants mean we rent, user are renter. So you rent the server, you rent the network. So this will be, give you the idea that this one will provide service for each user. So you have a lot of users. And the network vulnerability that exists in network security norm in traditional way, then we also have it in cloud, because we kind of like simulate what we have in traditional way, and we want to move it like do it virtually in cloud. So whatever we have then in the traditional system, then we have in cloud too. And we also have malware too. So probably Kun Khong Sak from Trend Micro, we talk about like virus in cloud. Okay. And then we have like some SOA talking about the web application vulnerability. We develop on web. If web have vulnerability, then we have problem. Okay, so the new threat of cloud threat is co-tenants and empower you end user, the user that have like privilege, and then the problem will be the administrator, the cloud insider. So this is the threat that happened in cloud that's similar to what we have in traditional system. So CSA is an organization that taking care, like try to gather best practice or some guidelines for cloud securities. And they have been like issue like Notorious 9 in 2013 last year that we have the threat in cloud. So we have like data leaks, data loss, some traffic hijacking happen, insecure API, the API that is not good, okay? And then deny of service, we have DOS in cloud too. We have malicious insider, normal, someone doing cloud abuse. So users acquire account and use it to attack authors, okay? So that's cloud abuse. And then we have insufficient due diligence. This means that if you want to use cloud, you have to like study it well. You have to know what it can do, what it cannot do. So, and then we have share vulnerabilities. So that is Notorious 9 in 2013. So with that, then we have like the this model is from the infrastructure cover from hardware, virtualization, connectivity, and API. In the platform, cover integration OS, middleware, and then software as a service will be application data, content, metadata. And it means that at each level, you're gonna have the security control on each level, even at the application level, and also at the data. Okay, so I'm gonna try, if I post this slide so you can go to see the details. So this is show you what is the who responsible for the security. So the provider mostly will responsible for the infrastructure security and platform security. But for user have to responsible for the application level security, data security, and user security and monitoring, including identity services. So at this data, like for example, they recommend that if you're going to put your data on cloud, you should encrypt it. And the key have to be on your side, not on the cloud. Okay? So this is like some recommendation because provider, they're not really like knows when like you have example iCloud have been attacked. So that is something that we sometimes the provider is still learning to. Okay. So I will give some example of the management, some issue in the cloud that we should aware of, like for example user. When we have user at any center, usually it lasts forever, right? We never like try to disable or probably delete user from our system. But in cloud, if you have user on cloud, you should follow the like and probably try to track what they do. So from create user, you provide storage for user, and then you giving the role, okay? What role of use of that user? And giving the policy, and then set the permission to users to access the asset of the organization. And then you can manage quota, you can rename, you can have storage report. And then if the user have to transfer from one unit to another unit, do you track those users and what did he or she still be able to access to the asset that the old asset. Okay, so this is you have to have it in your cloud. So that is the inactive user policy. And finally, we should have like delete user. Okay. So, and that related to what we call identity life cycle. From create identity, you update, you like have password, you have move the identity, you have group of identity, you rename identity, delete identity, and then probably go to disable that identity. And another one will be on the data life cycle. When you put data on cloud, it's different from what you have in your data center. Usually in data center, you have it forever. And then in the server or on your session. Now, if you put data on cloud, once you generate the data, you use the data, transfer the data to some different servers, you transform the data, modify it, you keep the data on the solid in cloud. You may have backup of the data, you have another copy of the data on cloud. Then finally, if you don't want to use cloud anymore, you should destroy the data completely because you never know that someone will access to those data later on, and especially the sensitive data. And so data security in cloud, we talk about data in transit. So you should encrypt data when you send and receive data. Data at rest, so you keep data on the storage. They have what we call data provenance. So this is a process of tracing and recording originality of data, and then how it's reliable, how it's updated over time. This can be used for legal issue. Then data remnants, this is mean you have to make sure that the data that you have on cloud have been removed completely. Okay, that's all for my talk.
Thank you very much, Chancellor Sung Won. I would like to ask the audience if there is any questions. There are two microphones on the side of this room. No? Okay. Thank you very much, Chancellor Sung Won. Thank you. And right after this session, there is a 10-minute break. There is a coffee break right outside this room. Please use the back door. And then we will come back in around 10:55, according to the clock back behind you.